You're listening to a DM podcast.
Hi, I'm Nigel Marsh, and this is the Five of My Life podcast, the show where five choices reveal sideways insights into the lives, opinions, and lessons of interesting people. I was delighted when Josh agreed to take the Five My Life challenge. I first became aware of him because of his work presenting Weekend Breakfast on ABC News, and then went on to discover some of his other roles, be it as founding host of the HuffPost Live, or as a regular contributor on NBC's Today Show, or his much talked about regular appearances on the world's most popular podcast, The Joe Rogan Show. But the thing I most admire amongst Josh's varied output is none of the above. It's his fabulous show, Uncomfortable Conversations. Far beyond it being a vastly entertaining and enjoyable programme, which it is, I feel it is actually an important and much needed addition to the media landscape in these troubled times. A place for intelligent, nuanced, and crucially, helpful debate. Josh, welcome to Five of My Life.
Thank you. I can't wait. So, I'm delighted.
So you're having a bit of a nightmare day. Lost cat.
Oh, my
goodness.
You've got
to go on Sky News or something, or Fox News or whatever.
There are lots of Fox News. There are lots of things going on. The most important of which was that my three-month-old kitten ceased to exist inside the borders of my house.
Right.
Which was very traumatizing for my six-year-old daughter, who has come to love said kitten in the 2 weeks that we've had her. And so lots of running up and down the street, screaming the kitten's name. No point. Kitten doesn't know its name yet.
And where was it?
Turned out to be hiding behind a chest of drawers, like inside the drawers, but behind the drawer itself.
So little kiddies can get into chairs.
Can get anywhere.
Soft chairs.
You go, and then they
in
can't
the
get
sofa.
Out.
You go,
yeah.
What do you mean
it was
in the
covered
sofa?
In dust. You could barely see the kitten for the dust. Anyway.
Very good. Well, listen, thank you for squeezing us in, mate.
It's a delight. This is my recreation. This is my happy time.
Lovely.
No children, no lost cats.
Yeah, and you can pretend you're working. So you can
say
to your partner, oh, I've got to go.
I've got very important things to do. Nigel needs to talk to me.
Now, we start on Five My Life with the film.
Yes.
And I've got to thank you, mate, because I had never seen Pleasantville.
Is that right?
Yeah. I really adored it. I found it quite touching, but it's not about me, it's about you. Tell us why you chose Pleasantville, and maybe explain very briefly, if you can, what the film is to people who haven't
seen it. So Pleasantville is a satire of the way that we think about the past, and the past being and a revelation of how staid and conservative the past actually was in comparison to our whimsical recollections and romanticization of the way that things used to be, and the way that things would be if things were more ordered and more, I suppose, small c conservative. I mean, the plot basically is that a couple of teenagers in the 20th century get magically transmitted back into the world of their favourite 1950s black and white television sitcom, and they think it's fabulous until they realise just how boring and dull and conformist the whole thing is, and they shake up this world, and by bringing passion and sexuality and originality to this world, the black and white world starts exploding in colour. The local pastor pushes back against this as its depravity, and so it's this rich kind of interlocking of themes about, I suppose, the virtue of stepping outside the box, you know, the virtue of being an outsider, the virtue of upsetting the apple cart. And it dropped at just the time when I was in my late teens and was trying to figure out what to do with my life and trying to figure out whether I should conform and how I fit in, as one does in one's teens. And there was this movie that came along where it was like, actually, all the ways of conforming and being appropriate are bonkers and bananas, and it's a pathway to nowhere. You just go out and do your own thing, and the world will explode in color in the way that you bring the color into being. And that was really empowering at that time in my life.
And what were the things that you were potentially going to conform to?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, do you go into a conventional career, which is stable, or do you take risks? And I went into an extremely high-risk, high-reward industry, which is entertainment and the media. Do you accept other people's checkboxes and identity buckets that they have for you. You know, this was also a time in my life, I guess, where I haven't really thought about this particular layer on Pleasantville, but it was coinciding at a time when I was dating boys and I was also dating girls. I didn't feel confused, but I felt entirely detached from what you might call the gay community, because it was very rigid in its articulation of what gayness was. It had a certain way of walking, a certain way of talking, a certain way of dressing, a certain politics. It was oiled up hot guys sitting astride a giant inflatable penis on Oxford Street in Sydney. None of that was me. So the question of, do I jump into that category and sort of come out as that thing? Would that make me a bad gay? Do I just sort of hide it and, you know, go along with dating girls and just assume that that's the thing you do because that's the thing you do? So I think those would be probably the two things. Yeah, how much risk do you want to take, both personal and professional, and how much of a middle finger do you want to give to other people who tell you about the ways that you're supposed to behave and the binary options that you have to choose between?
Are you aware of a lady called Naomi Mora?
No.
So there's a comedian I had on. She is Australia's only lesbian, Lebanese, ex-Jehovah's Witness stand-up comic.
I do know this woman now that you mention her, and I may have interviewed her on ABC Weekend Breakfast, which I used to co-anchor.
So it leads me to want to ask you a question, because her story, I mean, I shouldn't laugh, but I did on the episode, is so she comes out to her dad, and he goes, not a problem, calls his wife in and his other children and says, just got an announcement, Naomi's dead. And you can fuck off. And then didn't talk to her for 20 years. I mean, literally didn't talk to her for 20 years.
Unbelievable.
But hardcore, is, letters not returned, wouldn't come to her. Right. And then, long story short, she came to the door. She kept in contact every now and then with her mum, came to the door to deliver some loo paper in COVID, and dad opened the door and went, oh, hello, Naomi. Have you put on weight?
Wow.
And he went, a couple of pounds, dad. Anyway, and he got dementia.
Ah.
So it wasn't. So I'm laughing, which I shouldn't be on the episode. Right, so he hasn't actually come to an accommodation.
Yeah, right. Yeah, so he's just forgotten.
Any time. Yeah, yeah. I don't know. Now I remember. Yeah,
that's
fuck
right.
Off,
or if he doesn't remember, you're going to have to tell him again. And he's going to have the same reaction. Yeah.
So how was your mates, your school, your family, the gay thing?
They were great. Yeah. They were great. I mean, I was growing up in a very bohemian, creative enclave of a big city. That was not the problem. The problem, if anything, was there was too much of a good thing, in the sense that it was fine to choose to be gay, but that meant a whole bunch of things, right? It wasn't that there was any. I mean, there was the latent homophobia of the 1990s, but I mean, it's not a big deal. I mean, I never felt like I would be demeaned or less than for coming out. I just didn't feel like I was coming out into anything that was constructive or that resonated.
So back to Pleasantville. I found it quite, I'm a bit of a softy, I found it quite sort of hopeful, really. You know, people can change and all. I mean, it's a bit clunky, you know, black and white goes coloured.
Yeah.
But the mum, Joan, whatever she's called, I was just really quite lovely and touching.
And I mean, spoiler alert, her epiphany comes because she masturbates in the bath.
That's where she
touches herself for the first time and the world explodes. I think the tree outside bursts into flames, doesn't it, when she does that, right?
In colour flames for the first time.
And the firefighters come, and the firefighters have never put out a fire before, because in Pleasantville all they do is rescue cats out of
a
tree.
They should have been at your house this afternoon, mate.
Exactly, where's the cat? It's sweet. I think that's right. It also reminded me a bit of my dad. Like, dad has a furious passion for what is beautiful about the world and what is, you know, almost he almost regards it as being our moral duty not to get bored of things and not to.
I'm liking him, right?
Yeah, he's a great guy. You know, he doesn't. There's nothing that would have irritated him more than people being like, "Oh, fuck my life," you know, like, "Oh, blah blah blah," you know, same shit, different day, like. You are alive.
Yeah,
we're here. It's incredible. Like, you could so easily not have been alive.
Yeah,
you know, or you could be born in some shithole, or you could, you know, you might have been born a factory farmed animal or something.
You're a
human being. There are trees and stars. You're here for like nothing.
Yeah,
enjoy it. And I think Pleasantville kind of captures a little bit of that sense of wonder.
Did I read somewhere that Dad might be suffering from dementia?
Yes, he has Alzheimer's now. It's both rough and it's also corrosive precisely because it's not as rough as death. By which I mean, when he was diagnosed, a lot of people said, oh, this is going to be a really long grieving process of, you know, losing, gradually losing someone you love. And what's really tricky about it for me, and, you know, maybe just around the corner I'm going to hit a wall of grief that's going to annihilate this analysis. But so far, what's tricky about it for me is that when a person dies, no matter how old they are, if their brain isn't riddled with dementia, there is some kind of cue that happens at the moment of death that provides a context for our grief. Like, they are there in a way that you can talk to them, and then they're not there anymore and you can't talk to them. You have the funeral, you go through the process that all mammals go through when they lose a loved one, and you come out the other side, perhaps refreshed, perhaps renewed, you've had some kind of a catharsis. What's weird for me about Alzheimer's is every day is incrementally the same as the last, and yet the person's basically gone, and you've never had the cue, you've never had the context for grief. It's like this big grey smear. It's like the most mediocre disease in the world. You're going from vitality and insight and passion and astuteness to, you know, almost a vegetative state, and it's a frog in a boiling pot syndrome where there's never a cue to actually reckon with it. So it sort of creeps up on you or me, and of course when he dies that will be a very sad day, but it won't be the same as if he'd gone from just being a very old person and dying, if that makes sense.
Well, it makes more sense than you might realise, because my dad had that journey for 10 years.
Yeah.
Exactly that. And it was slightly...
Did you find any grief points? Did you find any cues?
So it was... and this is five of your life, not mine, mate. But it, it is, because he was in England and I was in Australia, I got the mid point of what you were talking about. So I didn't visit him every day or every week. I'd visit him once a year. And so I had a grief point 10 years every year in a row, because I would turn up and my vision of dad would be happy, smiling, laughing bloke, because I would, that's the vision you keep in your mind. And then you meet some bloke strapped to a, I'll start crying, strapped to a chair with a sort of a seatbelt thing, dribbling like a skeleton. Bizarrely, he had a full head of hair until the day he died. You know, like, what am I, some sort of clown? Every time I saw him, I was shocked anew.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know whether that's worse or better, in the sense that you don't have to, you don't have to be on the ride the whole time.
Right, and for my poor mum. Anyway, so awful. There you go. Hey, what a buzzkill we are.
Yeah, but I would also just say that there's something, to just bring it back to Pleasantville and to bring it back to that sense of his philosophy on life as being, it almost being our duty to find wonder in existence. The strange thing is he has retained that. He has not become, touch wood, a depressive, paranoid, you know, delusional, deluded person. He is a cheerfully deluded person, and still remarks about how beautiful the clouds are and how, you know, glorious sunsets are and how amazing trees are. And, you know, he doesn't really have the language to articulate that anymore, but he's retained that spark of joyfulness, which indicates to me that it's something deep and something profound in the way that he's hardwired.
Yeah. Now, your second choice is always the book, and you've chosen The Demon Haunted World by Carl Sagan.
When I was in my mid-teens, someone gave me the book Cosmos, which is Carl Sagan's history of science, basically. He made a very popular television series about it in the United States, which became, I think, the most watched public television show in the history of the world. And Cosmos is great if you want just a very brief, gripping, potted history of how humankind came to know the things that we know. And so there opened a period in my life where I just devoured all of Richard Feynman, Richard Dawkins and Carl Sagan, and you know, my mind just exploded, as one's mind does when you're 15 and you suddenly realize anything that's, you know, extraordinary, whether that's losing your faith in religion or finding a religion and becoming a fundamentalist or whatever it might be. I mean, in my case, it was the true realization that we are collections of rare material that spewed out of distant stars that somehow aggregated itself into organisms that have evolved to become sufficiently self-aware that they're able to figure out and deduce for themselves the fact that they are star stuff, and then wonder at that as they wander around on this speck of rock whirling around a blazing nuclear power station.
A vast, meaningless universe.
On the outer spiral arm of a galaxy, which is but one of, you know, hundreds of billions. Like, this was a stage in my life where I could recite the Monty Python, you know, song, the Eric Idle song, for word for word. And I think the most profound book of the several that I read there was Demon Haunted World by Carl Sagan, which is his sort of call to arms to people to be rational, a defense of avoiding foggy thinking, bad thinking, groupthink, pseudoscience, mysticism, and a defense of skepticism. And he paints a picture of a world, and he's writing, I don't know when, 70s, 80s? I'm not sure when the book was published.
I think it was 98, 95.
Okay, so it must have been his last book, probably. Yeah. And it's his plea and portrait of a world that could soon come to pass, and where people are increasingly divided by their superstitions, conspiracy theories, gullibility, susceptibility to being misled by tyrants and populists, susceptibility to being misled about vaccine misinformation and other forms of pseudoscience. And this kind of chaotic world of stupidity is portrayed by Sagan with a terrifying sort of perspicacity, because when you look back on it now, some of the things he talks about populist leaders playing on the worst in our nature, you could be ripped straight out of the headlines of the past decade. So that, along with Unweaving the Rainbow, which is a book by Richard Dawkins, which is his most poetic book, which is the title Unweaving the Rainbow refers to when scientists invented the prism and were able to discover what light is, and that light is actually made up of a rainbow, and were able to create rainbows in a lab. One man of the cloth, a religious pastor who was anti-scientific, was saying, you know, the scientists will stop at nothing. They'll just demean everything. They'll even unweave the rainbow in their quest for their own, you know, glory. As if it was a bad thing for us to understand rainbows, as if rainbows are more beautiful if you're ignorant of what they are. And Dawkins's point is that rainbows, you know, just as beautiful, if not more beautiful, if you understand what it is. There's a beauty and a majesty in comprehending this cosmos. And those two books, Demon Haunted World by Sagan and Unweaving the Rainbow by Richard Dawkins, really laid the groundwork, I think, not just for the context in which my dad's sense of wonder and majesty that we were talking about in terms of Pleasantville could find its actual fruition, where I could say, yeah, it's incredible to be alive, sunsets are beautiful, and comprehending the sunset and having a respect and a reverence for our ability to comprehend things is the pathway to appreciating the beauty and majesty of life and existence, in the absence of my being a deeply religious person. They also, in an important way, I think, laid the groundwork for my career, which has become essentially a mission to help people think about things more rigorously and to point out the ways in which we might be mistaken, in which we might fall for bullshit, trying to have conversations that are fearless and honest and reflect my deep faith in the utility of trying to make sense.
Gosh, how wonderful that your life panned out, that those books came into your life then. So for me, I went to study theology, but part of the theology was ethics and logic and philosophy. And it's brilliant, because forget where you end up. You are able then to make your own mind out. I say to my kids, is you absolutely haven't got to agree with Dad.
Yeah.
But you do have to be able to argue properly.
Yes, just to sound like a boomer, which I'm not, but I do share some of the concerns. There is a sense, I think, among a younger generation that the right position to take is self-evident and doesn't really need to be interrogated. So traditionally disenfranchised or marginalized communities need to be listened to. And they do need to be listened to. But not everything that they say is going to be true, and not everything that they say is going to be the right way forward, and not everything that they say is even going to be reflective of the ground of the of all of the opinions within that community. It might just be a university educated, largely white language game that is being played in order to signal virtue to mostly white university educated people about how much we care about our about people of color or about transgender people
and
or about indigenous people.
Of picking a team. Many people, I think the popular, the village square, which is why your uncomfortable conversations, I'm just saying this because you're on my show, it's bloody brilliant because you can have a conversation where it's not about having to agree, but can we actually talk about stuff?
Yes. I mean, we're becoming more tribal. We're becoming more, it's just becoming harder and harder, I think, largely due to social media algorithms, largely to due to people seeking out ideas that either reinforce what they already believe or demonize what they disagree with. It's getting harder and harder to even know that the way that the things that you say could land to other people. I mean, I hope that uncomfortable conversations is a way to try to articulate at least the contours of the disagreement in a way that both that all people are going to find reasonable. I'm not a centrist in the sense that I just think that I'm going to inhabit the halfway point between any two ideas, right? You know, if there were Nazis and there were anti-Nazis, I'd be halfway between them, being like, well, the Nazis have some good ideas. No, I'd be the anti-Nazi, right? But usually in a demos where there are a whole bunch of different ideas bumping into each other, there are some ways of seeing things that are that you would find, you know, your enemies have a way of seeing things that you would find compelling if you were them.
Yeah.
I mean, almost prima facie, right? If you weren't you, if you were a different person, then you would see the world the way that person sees it. And so I think a little bit of empathic imagination, intellectual empathy to say for us to try to articulate the way that things occur, not for us, but for people who we disagree with, is the only way for us to, I mean, stitch together a democracy and survive the 21st century, survive the challenges of the 21st century.
Your program, Uncomfortable Conversation, I think it's brilliant, personally. I think it's absolutely, it genuinely, I think it's important, not just brilliant. Anyway,
we could talk, ladies
I can't get
gents.
A word in edgeways, bloody hell, mate. Your third choice, and all the songs go on to the 5 Mile Life Spotify playlist.
Great.
That is a sensation because it is algorithm busting. Now you've chosen Empire State of Mind by Jay-Z. Tell us about that.
Well, it was a time when I had I'd moved to New York City. I wanted to break into broadcasting there in some capacity, and I got a show on Discovery Science Channel, which was like a smart-assy look at science news, basically a weekly show. And this was in 2008. This was my first ever gig, and we ran for 3 seasons. And the financial crisis was exploding all around us. I mean, New York City was falling apart. The United States was falling apart economically. It was not a good time to have a reasonably expensive topical show that couldn't go into reruns on a small network. So the pin was pulled. I thought, you know, maybe I'll go to LA for a while, see if there's, you know, more opportunity out there. Went to LA for a year, lived in Venice Beach, had an absolutely miserable time. I'd lost money in the financial crisis. I'd been sold a bad investment back here in Australia before I left, and I was in debt, had no real income, and it was a bad year. And I got a job hosting a dating show, just a pilot. It was just a pilot for a dating show in New York City. And so I thought, yeah, I'll fly back over for it. It's a little bit of money, even if it's cheesy. The only time they had to rent the studio space when it was cheapest was after another show had wrapped at like 10 p.m. So they scheduled this pilot shoot in this studio in Manhattan from 10 p.m. to 4 a.m. And we shot 2 episodes of this show. And I was really tender, seriously considering giving up the dream of presenting TV, radio, podcasts and things, and thought maybe I'll just go back to Australia and become a producer or something. Maybe this has not been, you know, I gave it a shot, but
get back in your box.
I don't
man.
Want this roller coaster. Exactly. Yeah. Get back in the box, go back to Pleasantville. And I walked out of the studio into the streets of Manhattan, and I was staying with a friend of mine in a place that I used to live in the East Village. And it was on the complete other side of Manhattan, so it's probably about a 50-minute walk. And instead of getting a cab, I decided to just walk across Manhattan at this point. And I started listening to my playlist, and Empire State of Mind came on. This was the year that it had just come out, I believe. And I walked across New York as the sun was rising and as the city was waking up at sort of 5 to 6 in the morning. And people were starting to put out their trash, and people were going for jogs, and homeless people were waking up, and limousines were starting to cruise by. And I watched the sun rise over this metropolis, and I just felt like I have to get the fuck out of Los Angeles and come back to New York and, you know, have faith that something will happen. And in that moment, listening to that song, feeling all of my patriotic pride towards the Big Apple swelling in my chest, I kind of got a reinvigorated sense of possibility, of the kind of eclectic madness of New York, the infectious creativity of the place, the ridiculous audacity of the place, the contradictions of the city. And I went back to LA and packed up my stuff and flew back to New York. And the next year I met the guy who I ended up marrying, and the year after that
in New York,
and the year after that I got a job. I got my big break, which was on the Huffington Post at the time, was the most read online only news website in the world, and they were trying to branch out into streaming video, and they tapped me as one of the founding producers and hosts of their streaming video network, HuffPost Live, which I then did for the next 5 years. And the rest fell into place. But had it not been for that sunrise walk and the dulcet tones of Jay-Z.
I love stories like that on Find My Life, where people sometimes, like a film or a song, genuinely change the trajectory of their life.
Yeah, and I still can't hear it without... Like, if it's on in the background, I try to walk away, like, all right, have it turned off. It's not something that I listen to recreationally. It's too meaningful.
But it genuinely, I feel New York... Maybe it's because of all the films or whatever, but I don't go there often. I've probably only been there 10 times in my life. But in some ways, it's the capital of the world.
Yeah.
I mean, I know it isn't, but something like, wow. And then if you're hearing that, it's like the Sinatra.
New York. Yeah.
You go, standing on the street, in my corporate job, used to have, you know, I'd be flying to meet the big global CEO, and it would just feel slightly more important than if I was going to, I don't know, Boston or Paris.
Oh, totally.
And you go, I'm in New York, and the steam coming out. And
it is.
So the guy that you met in is that Sean?
That's Sean, yeah.
Is he a Yank?
Yes.
So you dragged him to Australia?
I dragged him out. God bless him. I don't know. Ask his mother how she feels about that. He liked, he'd come out. We came out here to visit a lot. He liked Australia. He, you know, was interested in a change. And basically, when we decided to have kids and go through the surrogacy process of having a family, New York's a fabulous place to be in your 20s. It's not a great place to, you know, it's a very expensive, and it's got a lot of hassles if you're a middle-aged family trying to raise little kids. I didn't want to be taking kids down strollers on icy steps down into a subway and, you know, worrying about what preschool they were going to get into in order to get into the right primary school, to get into the right college, and have to deal with private health insurance and New York City taxes and sanitation and what. Like, it's Australia's, why wouldn't you live in Australia?
Hey.
So much easier.
Now, you have chosen the fourth choice is possibly my number one place that I want to go to. And I have never been there. You bastard. You've chosen Easter Island.
Yes.
And so I just want to, I mean, maybe we'll talk off air. I just want to hear all about East Rhine because I really want to go. But you specifically have said the rim of the volcanic crater. But there are three of them, mate. Which
yes,
one?
The big one.
Rano Cow.
The one where the township is.
Yeah. I've been Google imaging at that.
Wow. So speaking about sunrises, right? Yeah. And sunrise in Manhattan. While I was living in New York, I'm a bit of a travel hacker. So I play a game of arbitrage with frequent flyer points and acquire them cheaply. And then
wherever they can go, wherever, you go.
And yeah, and so I go.
Like it.
So a cheap fare came up with LATAM or LAN Chile, one of the South American airlines. And I think it was about $800 or something in business class return to anywhere in, these whole selection of places in South America, one of which was Easter Island. So I thought, I'll just take a long weekend.
God,
and go
mate,
to Easter Island.
Good on you. Good on you.
Go to Santiago for a night, Easter Island for three nights, and then back to New York.
Brilliant.
And, on a lie flat bed, yeah. $800. So I thought it was just going to be a whimsical thing and this is a weird little place. And it was. And I was by myself.
Right.
And I rented a quad bike. I'd been told that, the thing to do in addition to riding around the island, which I did and beheld the big statues, the big heads and everything, that's great. The thing to do is go to the volcanic crater at sunrise and watch the sunrise. So I set my alarm for 4 or whatever, and I rode up there on my quad bike. And unbelievably, I was the only person there. There was no one else there.
It's huge. It's a mile across.
It's massive.
Yeah,
massive. Yeah. So you're sitting on this crater. And there are moments in my life where I have expected some kind of epiphany and haven't got it, like the Grand Canyon or something. Like, yes. I got to the Grand Canyon, I was like, it's a big hole.
Yeah, I've seen it in films.
I've seen it. It's like, it's big. But actually, it's so big that you can't really appreciate the size of it. I couldn't. I mean, it looked like a canyon in the Blue Mountains. It's pretty.
Yeah.
But like, I sat there for 10 minutes waiting to be touched by the Spirit of God. And I was like, yeah, no, it's not happening. It's a big hole in the ground. Great. Get back in the car. Go and get some hot dogs. But on the rim of that volcano, like as the sun rose, channeling Dawkins and Feynman and Sagan, right? Yeah. Here I am sitting in the middle of the biggest ocean on this blue-green rock as the rock tilts towards its mother star, and that star comes into view in its blazing orange glory across the blue water. I'm capable of marveling at that. Because I'm, again, made of the stuff that comes out of the stars. And I'm surrounded by this huge rim of this extraordinary geological volcanic phenomenon that is just a pop mark, a pinprick in the crust of this blazing rock that's boiling with magma underneath my feet. And I was like, it was just one of those moments where, I mean, I think it actually changed my relationship to spirituality for the rest of my life. I mean, it turned me from a diehard atheist into someone who was agnostic to the question of whether or not there's some vast ineffable purpose behind the cosmos and whether that purpose has a consciousness and could be called God. Because it was like, what the fuck is this all about? What on earth am I doing in this spot? And why am I aware of myself at all?
I just love your choices. So would you recommend, without the free air miles hack, me going? Is it worth me going? If you paid...
I think with no expectations and just a sense of curiosity. And yes, it's weird. It's weird. This ancient extinct civilization in the middle of nowhere.
I didn't know about the wonderful volcanic... I mean, I've been looking at... pictures of it. It's like a perfect, it's like
it's
someone has dropped
a
cricket ball in some flour.
Yeah, that's right, exactly.
Incredible.
Yeah. It's the way that an 8-year-old would draw a volcanic island, if you ask them to.
The fifth choice is The Possession.
Yes.
And usually that's my favourite one because guests open up. But mate, you're like you've been spilling your guts all over the studio. So come on, disappoint us. Well, you've chosen, actually it looks amazing from just the description, a ticket stub of The Late Show with David Letterman. You were in the audience.
Yes.
Tell me about that. How old were you?
I was 18.
God, so you had some glory. It's all downhill from here, mate.
It's all, mate. The days, the glory days are behind me.
LA, New York,
I didn't have kids and get married until I was well into my 30s. And so I had a whole life. Right. Like, you know, I never wanted to be someone who just settled down at the age of 20. I lived a great life. So when I was 18, when I left school before going to university, I deferred uni for a year.
Right.
And wanted to backpack around the world. I was going to backpack with a friend of mine. He decided to go straight to university. And I was like, you know what, I'll just do it anyway. Worked, you know, for 6 months at five jobs and, you know, all that kind of backbreaking labor, and saved up $10,000 and traveled around the world. And I'd always been a fan of Woody Allen and Jerry Seinfeld and, you know, Dave Letterman. But Letterman in particular, when Letterman got The Late Show, which was basically Johnny Carson retired, and there was a fight over who would get The Tonight Show, which was the crown jewel of American broadcasting. And it was between Jay Leno and Dave Letterman. They gave it to Leno. Letterman did the show after The Tonight Show and was upset. They eventually reneged on Jay Leno and offered it to Letterman. Letterman asked Johnny Carson's counsel, and Carson said, don't take it off Leno. It'll always feel like you stabbed him in the back. Go off. You know, do your own thing. Be honorable. So Letterman went off and created a rival show to The Tonight Show. And for the next 20 years, the two of them battled it out in the ratings. And for the first time in history, there were these two shows. Now, of course, there are a million. There's four or something.
Yeah.
But at the time, there were two. And when that happened and Letterman created his own show, one of the Australian free-to-air broadcast television networks picked it up. It must have just been in their bunch of rights that they had in a deal with CBS or something. And they would put it on at these random times at 1:15 in the morning one night, and, you know, then at 2 o'clock in the morning on another night. And I would set my VCR to tape it.
Right.
And then I would copy the best bits onto another VCR. And I had dozens and dozens of VCRs. This is like me at the age of 14, right? 13 or 14. VCR tapes of Letterman highlights. And at when he was at his peak, I mean, he was the speed of his mind, the acerbic nature of his wit, his kind of grumpy misanthropy, I suppose. Like his sort of, he oozed a kind of disdain for showbiz, a disdain for humankind, a subtle contempt towards many of his guests. And there were some sparring matches between him and celebrities. I mean, if people haven't seen his legendary interview with Madonna in, I guess it was about 93 or 94, he'd been doing jokes about how promiscuous she was for years, and she'd declined coming on the show. She finally relented. She comes out and she sits down, and the first words out of her mouth, fuck you, Dave. And she refuses to leave the stage. She just continues to disrupt everything. And watching his, you know, what's the saying about there's nothing more beautiful than a brilliant mind in panic or in flight? You know, he was just a master. And so when I was traveling around the world, I mean, the main thing that I wanted to do in my international trip was just go and see Letterman. So I literally wrote away like 8 months in advance to get a ticket for the night that I knew that I wanted to be there. And they mailed it all the way to Australia. It was ticket number one of that particular performance. Right. I got in before anybody else. And that, to me, just being there in that studio, in that auditorium, seeing this person who I had lionized as a kid, and watching him do his craft at what to me was the epicenter of broadcasting in a city that was the epicenter of the world was like a drug. I mean, I was like, why wouldn't you want to do this in any capacity that you could?
So this is like a professional Easter Island. This didn't disappoint.
Not at all.
And then here you are. You might have had your heyday, you know, tooling around LA and New York when you were an 18-year-old, but you are about to enter your second or maybe your third heyday because you are going large. You are going to be the Rogan better watch his arse. There's a new sheriff in town and I'm talking to him and he's called Szeps.
I believe that. I mean, I had a very fun 20s and then I had a very successful stint in my 30s when I was on HuffPost Live in New York, and that was great because that we felt like we were at the cutting edge of digital media and all the big stars came by. And yeah, now I do feel like there's enough of a change in the way that people are consuming media that it's clear that in 10 or 20 years, the idea of there being broadcast television and broadcast radio is going to be meaningless. Everything's going to be digital.
You call it heritage media. And you go, that's brilliant.
Legacy media, you might have said.
It is a thing, but it's not mainstream.
It's not mainstream
anymore. Kids don't
know. That's right. You're right.
It's just like the old stuff.
Which is
fair enough, but it's not.
Exactly.
It's not dominant. It's just the old stuff.
That's right. Yeah, and I mean, the proof is in the pudding. When I was in New York and on HuffPost Live, I got a gig doing a regular spot on the Today Show, the NBC Today Show, which, much like Letterman, is, you know, a huge institution.
Yeah.
I mean, this is, it's at 30 Rockefeller Center. Yeah, you know, it's iconic, you know, the Al Roker and Kathy Griffin and Matt Lauer and all this. And so I would, a limousine would pick me up for, you know, at 4 a.m. from, it was great. It was like, you know, I felt so fancy, and I'd go in and I'd do 4 minutes of bantering about the news with Kathy and Kathy Lee and Hoda and Al Roker. And then a limo would take me to HuffPost Live. And that ostensibly is the most important show in America. It ostensibly has hundreds of millions of viewers, and my podcast at the time would not get any bump when I was on the Today Show. I might get one text message from, you know, an elderly friend of a friend or colleague saying, oh, saw you on the Today Show, you know, while I was at an airport lounge or something. You know, you were on in the background. And I would go on Joe Rogan's show, which is a show that I've been on 7 times, and every time my podcast would become either the number one or number two ranked podcast on all of iTunes for the next 72 hours after going on Joe's show. So who has influence?
Yeah.
What's mainstream? The Today Show is mainstream because it's on in the background while people make their kids breakfasts and they're not paying attention to it.
Yeah.
But a podcast or a YouTube show that people really like and are passionate about, you know, forget about the fact that the raw numbers are even larger or just as large. Even if the numbers were 1/10, I'd much rather have 1/10 the audience who cares deeply about what I'm saying than 10 times the audience who's making ham sandwiches and putting their kids' shoes on.
I think what you are already doing and what I gather you're going to do, the world needs it. And you're the right person to do it.
Well,
don't let any marketing numpty push you in the wrong place.
It's a good point because there is the risk of audience capture. I mean, that's the thing. So, I mean, we're expanding Uncomfortable Conversations from 1 episode a week to 3 episodes a week.
How
we're launching
the hell
a YouTube.
Are you gonna do that?
Well, I'm not gonna have an ABC show anymore. I've been presenting the afternoon show on ABC Radio City
daily
for the past 2 years, every single
day.
So
you're going part time.
Now I've got I'm part time. Okay. Exactly. I've got all the time in the world. So yes, I'm creating my own, you know, whether I will expand a la Barry Weiss into creating an independent media company that has other people working for me, you know, remains to be seen. But in the meantime, people should subscribe to my brand new YouTube channel
and
buy tickets to my live shows, which we'll be doing, you know, Uncomfortable Conversations tours, and of course subscribe to the podcast, and you can become a premium subscriber on the Substack. Like there's this whole kind of empire of Uncomfortable Conversations that I can preside over and hopefully have a constructive role in helping people to have better conversations about the most important things, challenges that face us. And I'm mindful of not sort of chasing clicks, chasing what's going to pander to the audience, because I do think that my point of differentiation is that I don't pander and that people always know that I'm going to tell it like it is.
Are you aware of the Guilty Feminist podcast?
Yes.
So Deborah Frances Wise.
Yeah.
So I mean, I'm drawing an analogy. There you go. I mean, you couldn't be more different. But so her shtick's the wrong word. Her wonderful thing is I'm a feminist, but.
Yeah.
Right, so I went on a march, a bra burning march.
Yeah.
But I missed the speeches because I ducked into David Jones to buy some.
But
she's razor sharp. She's had like 115 million downloads.
Yeah. Wow.
Right. But she didn't set out to get that. It was obviously, you know, the world's best, most famous intellectual powerhouses gravitate towards Deborah's live show. I've seen her in the Opera House. That being true to what you are, and it being proper, it was enabling women to be feminist and not be perfect.
Yes.
It's like you be gay, but you haven't got to bestride a blown up cock on a truck. I mean, you can if you want, but you haven't got to.
Only every other Saturday. Not every Saturday.
Now, there are six choices on Five of My Life. Yes. So I've named the bloody show wrong. But it's too late now. We've been going for 5 years. Yep. Who would you like to hear on Five of My Life next and why?
Does it have to be a real person who you could book?
You're dead right. They have to be alive, not dead. And I have to be able to call them up.
Letterman.
Yeah.
Dave Letterman.
Yeah, great.
Would be fascinating.
Lock him in. I'll give him a ring this afternoon.
Give him a ring. Peter Berner is a comedian who has a place in my heart because I think he's one of the most underrated and funny and insightful Australian comics.
He's an artist as well,
Peter Berner.
He got the Archibald.
Peter Berner?
Yes.
Get out.
Yes, he did. He painted himself and he didn't win.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
The things you find out from Nigel.
Josh, this has been really bloody wonderful.
It's
and
such
I'm going
a joy.
To,
it's yeah. great. It's a great show. It's a great kind of... And it's a wonderful thing to have to unpack my own brain and using the prism of those five things. It's great. I've enjoyed it.
So my wife is going to hate you because I'm going to say, sweetheart, you know... You know, you wanted to go to Hawaii. Well,
Easter Island.
Josh, thank you so much for sharing.
Thank you.
On Five My Life.
It's a delight.
In the past, I've struggled with feedback. Taking feedback. Not good feedback. I love praise as much as the next person. But bad feedback. Criticism, constructive or otherwise. I get defensive. If someone would say, I didn't like that podcast episode or that article, I'd take it as an attack on my whole person. It's as if they'd said my kids were ugly when all they said was I didn't like that particular guest. Or I'd argue with it. I'd debate the points they're making. Or I wouldn't listen properly. Or I'd dismiss it. Or even worse, I'd dismiss the person who was giving the feedback. You know, like, who are you to tell me, you know, what you think about my book or my podcast or my event? And... a few years back, I realised that I was missing out on a huge amount of learning and growth by having this sort of gap in my armour. So I decided to work on it, and I think I've come a little bit better at it. And I found two strategies that were game changers for me, and I thought I'd share them just in case some of you find them helpful. So the first strategy for getting the most out of feedback is seek it out. Now, that's counterintuitive and hard because I'm used to avoiding it and seeking praise and affirmation instead. But I'm suggesting doing the exact opposite of what you might want to do. Run to the fire, so to speak. View it as digging for treasure, not as avoiding an ego attack. Actually look for constructive, critical feedback. So that's the first thing. The second thing is when you get some feedback, actively and intently listen to everything that is said with an authentic belief that they may actually be right or at least have one or two valid points. And be curious. Ask for them to elaborate and explain more. You know, you said you didn't like that podcast episode. Can I just understand why? You know, ask them for more. Ask them for suggestions for how to deal with the points they raise. You said you didn't like that episode because you thought it was too long or too short. How would you deal with that? And really importantly, do this even if you suspect that the person giving you the feedback is a total moron. And it's really important because if after genuinely listening and probing, you think their feedback is bollocks, fine, then you can dismiss it. But trust me, making a habit of creating space to seek out and actively, properly listen to feedback, wherever it comes from, can change your life. I hope that's helpful. Thanks for listening. And be sure to tune in next week to hear the delightful conversation with celebrity chef and businesswoman Maeve O'Meara. Please get in touch via my website, nigelmarsh.com.